I'm so glad to be here. So honored to be here that you would let one like me stand in this honored spot. But I just feel so good. Don't you feel good today? I feel so good. I've been uplifted by the choir here today. They've been lifting my spirit. They sang so good. I just asked the pastor about one of the songs. I said, what was that song? I promise you, Lord, I will hold out. I promise you, Lord, I will hold out. I'm so glad to be here with you. I see so many people I know, and if I tried to call out everybody's name, I'd use up my 15 minutes. But I see good friends, and you know, today, Pastor, a miracle has occurred. There's so many black militants and radicals in your church this morning. Would all the members of the People's Organization for Progress stand? Please give them a hand. They here this morning. Give them a big hand. And I think we ought to certainly give a hand to the members of the Social Action Committee that put this wonderful program on today. I'm sure the pastor will recognize all of them, and several of them are active members of the People's Organization for Progress. A friend of mine just walked in, he just sat down, been a friend for half a century. This is 2017. I met James Harris in 1967. He was my first track coach. Before I even started high school, he was running a track club for the Leaguers. How many people heard of the Leaguers, nonprofit organization, the Leaguers? And they used to run a track club in the summertime at Westside Park. And that's where I met James Harris, who himself had been a great athlete, had been a championship miler for Montclair State College. And then didn't leave his community, but came back to his community to help other young men and women through track and field. And he met me, and he said, Larry, you so slow, I can't put you in the 100 or the 200 or the quarter or the half. He said, but I can't. We don't have anybody run the 2 mile, so I'll put you in the 2 mile run. I was so slow, I used to get lapped twice on the quarter mile track. But I held out. And you know, it's bad to be last. See, the kids now, they have these new finished tracks, the tartan tracks, they call. When I was coming up, we had dirt and gravel. And they painted the lines on the dirt and gravel, and people had to wear cleats. And if you was the last one, you got all the mud from the people who were in front of you. So for several years, I just ate mud and ate mud and ate mud. But James Harris said, Larry, just keep practicing. Said, maybe try practicing twice a day. Not twice a day, no wins. Then I start 3 times a day. And then all of a sudden in my junior year, I held out. Not only did I come in first, I became the first person in the history of the city of Newark to break 10 minutes in the 2 mile run. But that was because somebody believed in me. See, what our young people need today is they need people who believe in them and want the best for them and are willing to go the extra mile to help them achieve their dreams. I can remember James Harris would take me to meets. Nobody was paying him to do this. He would take me all year round because Arts High didn't have a cross country team. We didn't have indoor track, just spring. And eventually I became the state champion record holder here in New Jersey, 9 minutes and 36 seconds. And I see our councilman here, Ted Green, give him a hand. Councilman Ted Green is here from East Orange. I just spoke at his Father's Day breakfast last year, and that was a wonderful affair. And I'm not gonna call any more names, but there's one more person I see out there, and that's Parthenia Major. Now, why am I calling out Parthenia Major? The pop members don't even know her. Parthenia Major was the teacher of two of my daughters. And I just have to tell you, Miss Major, that Nia got engaged this week to be married. Nia was her student. Nia is my middle daughter, and she just recently got hired by NBC. She's an anchor in upstate New York, NBC affiliate. She came right out of school. I'm proud of all of my daughters. My oldest daughter, Laini, has a degree in nursing and a degree in English and is working on her master's degree in nursing. And my youngest daughter, Imani, is in her junior year. They're all Rutgers graduates. And I'm so proud of all my children, all my girls. I'm proud of them. But I'm especially glad to be here with you today for this Black History Month celebration. And this is the first ever Black History Month celebration, Pastor, that I've ever been to that was called Justice Sunday. And I think that's very significant. And the pastor and I were talking earlier about one of our mutual friends. See, this is a small world, especially among those of us who have been struggling. We have a mutual friend, Carlton Woodward, that I graduated with over 45 years ago. And now Carlton is he's also a pastor in the AME church and is now pastor of a church in Harlem. But Carlton was with me when I started on this journey for social justice. And I just think it's wonderful that this church chose on its Founders Day to have Social Justice Day. And it's appropriate because this church is in fact a product of the Black freedom struggle, the African Methodist Episcopal Church is a cornerstone of the Black freedom struggle, over 200 years old. And I just discovered that its founder's birthday, Richard Allen, I knew that much, his birthday is February 14th. That's a significant day. I know everybody said that's Valentine's Day. But that's the founder of the AME's birthday, but it is also another great person's birthday who was said to be alive by the President of the United States alive and doing good things. Frederick Douglass claimed his birthday is February 14th also. But this just goes to show you, brothers and sisters, our history is all around us. The past is not dead. The past is ever present. Who would have thought the name of Frederick Douglass would have arisen in the controversy of this presidential election and in the controversy of the term of the person who was just elected? So I'm so glad that St. Paul's is having Justice Sunday, Social Action Sunday. I just wish every church in our community would have Social Action, Social Justice Sunday. Because if every church would do that, we would have an unstoppable movement, brothers and sisters. Because I tell you this, and you know it, I'm not going to tell you anything you don't know yourself. I'm going to tell you this. Our liberation struggle will not be successful unless the Black church is deeply involved in that struggle. And when I say the Black church, I mean all Black religious institutions of all faiths. But our struggle has in many instances been led by our religious leaders and been sustained by our religious institutions. I mean, where does the money come from for many of the efforts that we have been engaged in? Who funded the civil rights? Who funded Dr. King's work? Most of that money, if you read his book, Stride Toward Freedom, came from the members of churches who were poor people, but who understood that they were in an historical moment and that they had a responsibility and a role to play in this struggle. Their nickels and their dimes. And while we remember all the big name people in the Black liberation struggle, let's not forget the names of those people whose names are not in the history book, who in fact made that struggle possible, and who in fact gave their money, gave their time, gave their effort, went to jail so that we could have a better life. February is Black History Month, and there's so many important dates. February 1st, the birthday of the great poet Langston Hughes. February 1st is also that day when four students from Greensboro, from North Carolina A&T, sat in at a Woolworth's lunch counter in Greensboro, North Carolina, and started the sit-in movement. Last week, February 4th, was the birthday of another great freedom fighter, Rosa Parks. And while we remember the name of Martin Luther King and all the others, we must never forget the name of the mother of the civil rights movement, Sister Rosa Parks. In fact, we need to do more to remember the women as well as the men that fought in the civil rights struggle and civil rights movement. Of course, we remember Dr. King and all the others, but we must also remember Sister Ella Baker and Sister Fannie Lou Hamer and Sister Rosa Parks, and even before them, great women like Ida B. Wells that fought against lynching in this country, and Sister Mary McLeod Bethune, who started a magnificent educational institution with nickels and dimes, went on to train many of the great leaders of our community. The women have played as an important as role as the men have in our struggle, and they must be recognized. We remember this week, we just passed the anniversary, February 4th, the assassination of Amadou Diallo, who was shot 41 times in the vestibule of his apartment building, trying to get out his keys. No one went to jail for the death of Amadou Diallo. We remember this week, February 11th, the anniversary of the release of the great freedom fighter, Madiba Nelson Mandela, from prison, who many people believe. I know even I, when I was a student in the anti-apartheid movement, many of us believed that Mandela was going to die in prison. But he held out. The people of South Africa held on. They built a freedom movement. They built an anti-apartheid resistance movement. They built a political party, the African National Congress, and they fought how long? For almost 75 years. And then all of us remember, to our astonishment, Nelson Mandela walking through the gate of Poorsmore Prison out into freedom, came from a jail cell and became president of the new South Africa. Other great day here in February, February 23rd, the birthday of W.E.B. Du Bois, the greatest intellectual that America's ever produced. And at Harvard University, they're trying to put together a collected works of W.E.B. Du Bois. They're already at 50 volumes and counting. And how can we forget February 21st, the anniversary of the assassination of Malcolm X? And regardless of what your religious affiliation may be, I think we all recognize that Malcolm X was one of the greatest freedom fighters that we've ever produced here in our community and here in this country. And we must never forget the name and the contributions of Brother Malcolm X. And while I urge you to read Alex Haley's autobiography, more importantly, I urge you to read, brothers and sisters, and we must read. We must study our history. And not just during February. We got to study our history all year round. Black history is every day of the year. But don't just read the autobiography. Read what Malcolm X said. Read Malcolm X Speaks, a compilation of his speeches, another compilation by any means necessary, the last speeches of Malcolm X, and so on and so forth. And then we come to this day, February 12th, which is an auspicious day. February 12th is the founding day of the largest, oldest civil rights organization in the history of the United States, the great NAACP. And I say that with the utmost sincerity, the great NAACP. Many of those civil rights victories we had and that Dr. King had would not have been won had it not been for the support of the NAACP. And we must recognize the great role that the NAACP has played in our history. And also today is February the 12th, the birthday of Abraham Lincoln. Now, there's a lot we could say about Abraham Lincoln, but we're going to save it for another day. Let me just recommend to you Frederick Douglass's speech upon the death of Abraham Lincoln. Read that and you'll get a real good assessment, a bird's eye view, an eyewitness account of Abraham Lincoln. But people say, why do we celebrate Black History Month in February? Well, many of you know this, perhaps some of you don't, that the founder of what was at first called Negro History Week was Carter G. Woodson. How many people have heard that name, Carter G. Woodson? Yes. And how many of you have read The Miseducation of the Negro? Those of you who have not need to read The Miseducation of the Negro. Carter G. Woodson was a coal miner's son. He came from a poor family, but through a series of opportunities, he was able to get a good education and became the second person to get a PhD in history from Harvard University. And this was in 1912. Who was the first person? W.E.B. Du Bois was the first person to get a PhD from Harvard University in history. The title of his doctoral dissertation was The Suppression of the West African Slave Trade. And you can actually buy that book. His dissertation was published as a book. Du Bois says that nearly 100 million Africans were taken out of Africa. But behind W.E.B. Du Bois came Carter G. Woodson, and he had a doctorate in history, and he went back to his hometown, and he could have just stayed in the ivory tower and probably made a decent living as a professor. What did he decide to do? He decided to write a weekly column in the black newspaper, what they called back then the Negro newspaper, on our history, because we were told that we didn't have a history. Most people would make you think that our history begins with slavery. Our history begins with the origin of mankind. That's when black people's history begins. And before the period of enslavement, we have 6,000 years of civilization that we gave to the world. 6,000 years. And this is undeniable and indisputable, because some of what we did during those 6,000 years is still around. I tell you, if I see another program on the History Channel about the pyramids, they're still trying to figure it out. They just won't accept the fact that black people built those pyramids. They can't accept the fact. They want you to believe, like you saw in Anthony and Cleopatra, that the Egyptians were white, where Elizabeth Taylor, you know, and Richard Burton were white people. They will not accept the fact that these were African civilizations. I hate to say that, but I had to get into an argument, Miss Major, with one of my teachers with one of Nia's teachers in school. We were having open house night, right? Open house night. All the teachers talk to the parents about what they're teaching. So I went to Nia's social studies class. I'm sitting in the class. Nice man, greeted me well, sat down, started talking about history, started talking about what he was going to teach. Everything was fine. Then he said, well, we're going to teach a component about African civilization. And I said, oh, that's good. And then he said, when we finish that, then we're going to teach a component about Egyptian civilization. I said, wait a minute. I raised my hand. I said, wait a minute. The last time I looked at a map, Egypt was in Africa. If you're going to teach about African civilization, Egyptian civilization is African civilization. And we got a big problem. We're 50 years after the Black Power movement, and they're still not adequately teaching Black history in our schools. They passed a law called the Amistad Act, sponsored by Assemblyman Craig Stanley and Assemblyman William Payne, Bill Payne, that Black history is supposed to be taught not just in Black courses, it's supposed to be diffused into all areas of study in our schools. That is the law. The law was passed. But I challenge you who are here today to go into your schools and see if, in fact, they are implementing the Amistad law and teaching Black history in all areas of study. And I dare say that many of these schools will be found wanting. And this is an indictment upon us. I hate to say it, because what do you say after 40 years of Black power? After 40 years of having Black mayors, Black city councils, Black Board of Educations, Black superintendent of schools, and our students are still marching out of schools demanding Black history. Something is wrong with that, brothers and sisters. Something is wrong with that. And we must hold ourselves accountable. And we must not only point out those who are not doing the job, but we need to support those teachers who are, in fact, trying to do the job. Because too often, I've found the teachers that try to teach Black history, that try to tell, you know what Dr. John Henry Clark said? Dr. John Henry Clark said, we wouldn't need Black history if they just taught the truth. The only reason we have Black history is because the other history leaves out everybody else's history. It's only white history. And it's not really all of white people's history. It's primarily the history of white Anglo-Saxon Protestants. White people are very diverse, you know that. But this is a problem. And as we celebrate Black history, we must do all that we can to make sure our students get that history in the schools. But let me tell you something, you don't have to wait for a Board of Education. You don't have to wait for a Black scholar to come along. You don't have to have a revolution. You can go right to the Black bookstores like Source of Knowledge, downtown Newark, buy you some Black authored books, bring them home and sit down with your own children and read them. You don't need an act of Congress to do that. You can do that. We must do that ourselves. So, we find ourselves now at a very difficult period. But if we reflect on our history, we've had difficult periods before. And if there's one lesson we can draw from Black history, it is that we have the ability to survive the most difficult periods. Our people were brought here and changed. You know, recently there's been some controversy about immigrants, and I want for the record to say that I fully support immigrant rights. I support the struggles of those people who who are trying to become citizens, who are not citizens. And I have been on picket lines with them. But I heard a politician the other day say, and I'll tell you who it was. It was Governor Cuomo. And he was speaking at a program. And he's not the first politician to do this. He was saying that with the exception of the Native Americans, we are all immigrants. Well, I beg to differ with that. See, immigrants flee oppression. That's why people leave their countries, because they're being oppressed. They're being oppressed politically. They're being oppressed economically. They're being oppressed racially. There are a lot of reasons why people leave. But black people, the descendants of those who were enslaved in the Western Hemisphere, we did not leave voluntarily. And if people overlook that, that is a form of racism. If they're not willing to embrace the reality of the black experience in this country, either consciously or subconsciously, it's a form of racism. We didn't flee Africa. People came with guns and weapons of war and enslaved us, put us on ships against our will. And how do we know that? Because we fought back. We didn't just fight back here. We were fighting them in Africa. And some of the greatest fighters, some of the greatest resistance was by women that were leading the struggle in Africa at that time, who were queens of certain tribes and certain nations. We were fighting on the shores of Africa. We were fighting on the slave ships. You know the story of the Amistad with Sinke and his crew to turn that situation around. They overthrew the slave masters on the ship, and then, but they didn't know navigation. They got to Massachusetts, they went to trial, and they got their freedom, and they returned. But we fought them in Africa. We fought on the slave ships. We fought here in the United States. People would have you believe that somehow we liked being enslaved. I mean, they still pushing this stuff, especially now with all this revision of history going on. Herbert Aptheker writes in Slave Rebellions in Colonial America, there were over 400 slave rebellions in the United States recorded. And there were many more that were unrecorded. We never stopped fighting. We never accepted our enslavement. Some of us resisted openly through force of arms. Some of us resisted covertly in secret ways. But almost all of us resisted. And we are here today as a free people, primarily because of the resistance and the height of that resistance. This is why Abraham Lincoln is relevant, was during the Civil War. Lincoln wasn't winning the war. He issued the Emancipation Proclamation so that he could recruit black troops to do the fighting, because there were 100,000 troops sitting on the Potomac that weren't fighting. So what did he do? The first thing is he went and got U.S. Grant. Then U.S. Grant went and got Tecumseh Sherman. And they hate Sherman. They hate Sherman. They hate Sherman more than they hate Grant. And then he issues the Emancipation Proclamation on September 22nd. It didn't free all the slaves. It only freed those slaves in the states, counties, and parishes that were in rebellion. I want to ask this question. How many of you have actually read the Emancipation Proclamation? I want to ask this question. How many of our young people have ever read the Emancipation Proclamation? When I was coming up in school, we had to do elocution. We had to memorize the Constitution and stand in front of the class and say it. We had to memorize the Declaration of Independence and stand in front of the class and say it. They don't do that anymore. They don't do it. Every black child should have read the Emancipation Proclamation. Every black person, every person in this country should have read the Emancipation Proclamation, Because the truth be told, white students probably need black history more than black students need black history. But the point is that it's not being read. But in the Emancipation Proclamation, it tells you what states, what counties, what parishes are part of the Confederacy. There were slave states that were part of the Union, whose slaves were not free. And it didn't free them. It just said that if you can escape and get to Union lines, you can get your freedom. You join the Union Army. But see, the point is this. They did escape. They did join. 220,000 black men joined the Union forces. 186,000 in the Army, others in the other branches of service. And they fought valiantly. But you never hear about their stories. Most folks don't know that even during that racist period, 36 African Americans received the Congressional Medal of Valor, of Honor, for distinguishing themselves on the battlefield. And that's what won the Civil War, brothers and sisters. And we are a free people today because those black men went. 60,000 died, 100,000 mortally wounded. We need to find their grave, because they buried around here, these Union soldiers. And when Veterans Day comes, we need to go and at least lay some flowers and say thank you for breaking the back of the slave aristocracy in the United States of America. Wouldn't that be a good thing for the church to do? Find some of these black Civil War soldiers' graves. There's a little place in a town called Pennington. It's between Trenton and Princeton. You know, segregation was so crazy that the black soldiers couldn't even be buried in the same cemetery with the white soldiers. So the black people in Pennington bought some land, named that land the African Cemetery, and buried their black Civil War veterans there. And you can go and read the headstones of those graves, and they tell you, gunner, cannon master, cavalry. They wanted you to know through posterity what they did in that war. And we need to honor them, brothers and sisters, because slavery would probably have continued for at least another 50 years. Remember, Brazil didn't emancipate its slaves to the end of the 19th century. And it took a civil war. It took a civil war. More Americans died in the Civil War than in World Wars I, II, Vietnam, and Korea combined. Nearly a million died. Why did it take so much? Because so much was at stake. What was it? It was the system of slavery. This country is the richest country in the world today because of the wealth that was garnered from the slave trade. And that must never be forgotten. The wealth that was generated from slavery laid the basis of the Industrial Revolution that made this country a great industrial power. In 1960, the largest form of capital in the United States, larger than industrial capital and banking capital combined, was the capital invested in slaves. It was a money maker. And that's why it was so hard to end it. And that's why it took a war to end it. And when the war was over, they knew that they had to deal with the question of the stolen labor. Lincoln, in his last speech that he gives after he's elected in 1864, talks about what is owed to the emancipated people. And they actually passed the bill. You all walking around here talking about don't nobody owe you nothing. They passed the bill. The bill was written by, I believe, Charles Sumner. H.R. 29 was the bill. It offered $40 and $50 to every man, black man, that fought in the Civil War or his survivors. Where did the mule come from? Well, anybody that's grown up on the farm know that you either got to have an engine or an animal to break that ground. You either got to have a John Deere or you got to have a mule or a horse to break that ground, to bust that side. So what happened, see, where did this start? It started with Sherman. That's why they hate Sherman so much. When Sherman came down to Atlanta, fighting all the way down, as he went down, he just issued orders confiscating the slave master's property. He said, you're in rebellion. You've committed treason. Your land is now expropriated, and I'm giving this land to the people who worked it. Sherman distributed 400,000 acres of land. It was called General Order Number 15. And the legislation that was written by Charles Sumner, H.R. 29, was based on General Order Number 15. So they said, well, if we give them land, they gotta have something to work the land. So what would happen, the Union troops would give the mules that would pull cannons to the formerly enslaved people so that they would have a work animal to pull that plow. That's where the mule comes from. But the legislation actually says 40 acres and $50. And it passed. It passed both houses of Congress. They knew that something had to be done. They couldn't just turn loose 4 million people in society that did not have a stake in society. They had to have a way for themselves. They had to have some land. They knew that. It passed both houses of Congress. What do you think happened? Lincoln was assassinated. His vice president becomes president. His vice president is from Tennessee, Johnson, who was a Southern sympathizer. And his first act was to reverse Sherman's orders and write writs to return the lands to the slave holders. And he vetoed H.R. 29. But I'm telling you, if that demand was valid, was passed by both houses of Congress, it was valid in 1865, I think it's still valid in 2017. Black people, the descendants of the enslaved Africans, should receive reparations. Why? Because other people have received reparations. We're the only people that haven't received. They just gave, under Ronald Reagan, reparations to those unfortunate Japanese that were interned in concentration camps during World War II by that great president, Franklin Delano Roosevelt. I mean, he did do some good things in terms of social legislation, but the truth is, he gave the executive order to set up those concentration camps, not only for Japanese, but also for Italians. A lot of people don't know that part, but they ended the Italian incarceration after about a year and a half. But the Japanese stayed in those internment camps until the end of the war, because they were thought to be sympathized, you know, the Japanese sympathized with Japan, and these Italians that were interned were thought to be sympathizers with Mussolini in Italy. So Du Bois says in his book, Black Reconstruction, that at the end of the Civil War, we stood in the bright sunlight of democracy. And what happened? They passed the 13th Amendment, 14th Amendment, 15th Amendment. Abolition of slavery, citizenship, and the vote for men. What happened? We elected black people. Well, at that point, only men could vote. See, we say black people got the vote, the women didn't get the vote. Women didn't get the vote in America until 1921, the 20th century. But men got the right to vote, and black men elected what were called the Reconstruction governments, the state legislature, those former slave states. And what was one of the first things they did? They set up free public schools. Public education as we know it comes out of the Reconstruction experience of black people. See, a lot of people don't know that. We set up free public education, not just for ourselves, but for all children. That was one of the great reforms that came out of Reconstruction. But then Reconstruction only lasted, brothers and sisters, for about 12 years. In 1877, we had a situation like we've had in 2000 with the Gore-Bush election, and in 2016 with the Trump-Clinton election, one party wins the popular vote, the other party wins the Electoral College. And who gets compromised in the process? We do. And what happened after 1877, the compromise of 1877, 1878, federal troops are withdrawn from the South, the black codes are reinstituted. What you had was an attempt to re-enslave black people. And that in some ways was made possible by legislation that was passed. The 13th Amendment, which abolished slavery, Ava DuVernay in her movie talks about this in 13, the 14th Amendment abolished slavery except for those convicted of a crime. And that has been used as a way to kind of re-enslave our people. Convict lease labor comes into existence. You know what convict lease labor is? That's when you take people out of prison and you put them to work. Not just put them to work for the state, you put them to work for private corporations. The black codes enabled the enslavement, well, the incarceration of black people who in turn were made to work in coal mines, were made to work on the railroad. Y'all know about the chain gang. That's what the chain gang was all about. It was about free labor. Free labor. And this situation reached its apex in 1896 with Plessy versus Ferguson, with segregation becoming the law of the land in Plessy versus Ferguson. Now I know people talk about slavery, they talk about Jim Crow. They said, well, this was in the South. No, it wasn't. It was right here in New Jersey. Slavery was right here in New Jersey. Most slaves, when they got to Jersey, were told if they knew better to keep going. To keep going. Right now in Newark, they are catacombs that show where people were on the Underground Railroad in Newark and in Patterson and in other places. Slavery was right here. In fact, Jersey was the last state to, did you know that? The last northern state to abolish slavery. And it didn't abolish it by act of the legislature. When Lincoln issues the Emancipation Proclamation, Jersey legislature nullifies Lincoln's power to emancipate slaves in this state. When the 13th Amendment is passed, you needed 27 of the 36 states to amend the Constitution. New Jersey was not in the 27 state majority. It didn't do it. And it didn't do it for the 13th or the 14th Amendments. In fact, they didn't come back to ratify the 14th Amendment until 1980-something. And I think Senator Nia Gill had a hand in that. But this was a very racist state. You know, you don't have to go to Mississippi and Alabama to talk about segregation. Y'all know what it was about up here. You knew about colored night at Olympic Park. You knew about going down to the Paramount, the Lowe's, the RKO Proctors, the Bramford. Black people couldn't sit in the mezzanine. We couldn't sit in the main. We had to sit in the balcony. You know that we were segregated into certain neighborhoods. We couldn't come out. We couldn't get homes. They were redlined. The old Third Ward of Newark was redlined. You couldn't buy a house outside of there. You knew about segregated beaches down there in Atlantic City. You knew about segregated swimming pools. And I'm talking about public pools. They used to chase me down South Orange Avenue from Boylan Avenue Pool. Because they didn't want no black people up there. Anybody ever get chased along with me? Maybe some of y'all was running with me. They used to chase us from Boylan Pool. And that's Vailsburg. You wouldn't even know that that at one time was a segregated community. This was here in New Jersey. The first demonstration, civil rights demonstration of the contemporary period takes place where? At the White Castle on the corner of Hawthorne and Elizabeth Avenue. Because White Castle, you could buy a hamburger, but you couldn't work there. And it was Bob Kervin, I believe, in a chapter of CORE that led a protest against the White Castle. Y'all know about Bam Burgers. Black people couldn't try on no clothes in the Bam Burgers. No, you get locked up. You go in that dressing room in Bam Burgers. You could, Woolworths, talking about Greensboro, we have Woolworths in North. But this segregation was right here. We had a great civil rights movement led by Martin Luther King and many others. And brothers and sisters, I don't have time to talk about that right now, but we need to do more reading. Dr. King wrote at least 6 books that I know of. Stride Toward Freedom, Measure of a Man, Strength to Love, Why We Can't Wait, Where Do We Go From Here, Chaos or Community, Trumpet of Conscience. We got a king holiday, we got a king statue, and I dare someone to stand up in this room and tell me in what secondary curriculum is anything that Martin Luther King required study. I mean, what sense does it make to have a statue, to have the day off, if the children don't know what he stood for? His writings, at least some of them, should be required reading in every high school in every one of our communities. And I challenge you to go down. You got to make this happen. You know, Pastor and I were talking before we started today. What's one of the big problems that we have? It's being consistent. We demonstrate for a day, and we feel like we've done our part. But to change these institutions, to change these laws, to change these policies requires persistent, sustained pressure, ongoing, protracted pressure. It's a long struggle. And one of the great lessons of our history is that we are up to the task. We are the change agent of America. The fundamental, the greatest fundamental changes that have taken place in this country are in large part related to our struggle for freedom. Because as we advance our struggle for freedom, we expand freedom for everyone else in this country. That's always been the case. Some of the biggest beneficiaries of the black freedom struggle have been people who are not black. Some have benefited more than we have. But that's the nature of the thing that we are dealing with. So, one of the great lessons of our history is that we must be long-distance runners. Imagine being a slave. Imagine being like the fourth generation. You know how long slavery was in this hemisphere? 500 years of slavery. 500 years. How many generations is that? 20? More? 20 generations would be 400 years, right? 500 years. First the enslavement of the indigenous, and then they bring in the Africans. And when does this enslavement begin? It begins with the very person our black and brown children are taught to idolize, Christopher Columbus. I remember when I was in school, Ted, we'd be cutting out little Ninas and Pintas and Santa Marias. We sang Columbus Sail the Ocean Blue, 1492. For many weeks he was at sea, sailing ships at number 3, and la-di-da, we was all happy. Those were slave ships. Would little Jewish children be asked to cut out ships that took Jewish people and imprisoned them? No. Why do we accept that? You know why we accept it? Here's the secret. Because it's unpopular to stand up and speak out. Because there's a price to pay. Even in the most minor attempts to change, talk to these teachers who try to bring black studies to their children. And they'll tell you the resistance a lot of times doesn't come from white people, it comes from black people in supervisory positions. Because they scared. Nobody wants to rock the boat. But we wouldn't be where we are today if somebody wasn't rocking the boat, brothers and sisters. If somebody wasn't willing to stand out there and take the blows. Somebody, isn't this the lesson of Jesus? I'm no theologian. I'm not going to try to venture. Ron would do better at that than I would, you know. But isn't that the lesson of Jesus? That he, in fact, laid down his life so that others might have salvation? But isn't, in fact, that a metaphor for social progress? That, in fact, some of us have to lay down our lives, have to sacrifice in order that our children will have a better life. It's not going to happen just by itself. It's not going to happen through goodwill. Did not pass the Civil Rights Act and the Voting Rights Act. A mass movement got the Civil Rights Act and the Voting Rights Act passed. That's what got, that was just the cherry on the top, the passage of the legislation. They had to act because people were in motion. And now we see in 2017, people in motion again because they see tyranny raising its head. They see authoritarianism raising its head. I mean, somebody help me to understand, because I'm a simple guy. Help me to understand how the majority elects the district leader, the majority elects the city council person, the majority elects the state legislator, the majority elects the mayor, the majority elects the congressman, the majority elects the U.S. Senator, but somehow when we get to the President of the United States, 538 people over here overruled 137 million people that voted over there. Something is wrong with that. We need to abolish the Electoral College. It is a vestige. It is a vestige of slavery. It is a vestige of slavery, and I'm telling you, we've had two elections like this in 16 years, and unless we abolish this Electoral College, we will find ourselves at the brink, minimally, of political civil war, and maybe maximally something else. Because that situation is incongruent. It creates cognitive dissonance. You know, you tell me majority rules, you elect the student council president, majority rules. But when we get to the President of the United States, 538 people, that system, that college was set up to give the slave states that had smaller white populations a greater voice in government. That's why you have the 3/5 clause in the Constitution of the United States. That's why it's there, because the white populations in the southern states were so small that they couldn't elect the same number of representatives to Congress as the northern states that had the larger white populations. So what did the amendment to the Constitution do? It let the slave-holding states count 3/5 of their slave populations toward their total populations so that they would have an equal voice. But check it out. Check this out, because I've had these discussions with people. You know, most of the population of New Jersey is in the northern counties. We have 21 counties. Somebody said, well, we got to have this kind of a system to make it fair. But I want to ask you this. Should we set up a system? We got 21 counties. We'll have 2 people from each county. We'll have 42 people choose who the governor will be after everybody else has voted. Nobody would accept that. You would say we're crazy. What about U.S. Senate? We got 13 congressional districts. Should we take 2 people from each congressional district and have 26 people choose who the U.S. Senator will be after everybody else has voted? Nobody would accept that. No one would accept that. People want to keep that in place because they want a white minority regime to be in power here in the United States of America. Now, I know that that's a hard pill for some people to swallow, but I gotta call it like I see it. I'm 63, I don't care no more. Maybe this will be the last time I'm invited here to St. Paul. But I'm not gonna sugarcoat nothing. I'm not gonna cover up nothing. No, I'm gonna tell it like I see it. You have a right to catch me at the door and argue with me if you want to. But don't call me in here if you don't want me to say what's really on my mind. You know, this is a way. Right now, America looks a lot like South Africa. The demographics of this country are changing. They say that by 2035, that this will be a majority non-white country. Personally, I think it already is. They just fudging the numbers to try to buy some time. That's what I believe. I could be wrong, but we all know what direction things are going in. So what people are doing, they're putting things in place to preserve their power. And you can see parallels to this on the South African continent. In South Africa, they got an Independence Day. They got a flag. They got a parliament. But the white minority still controls the economy, still controls the diamond mines, the gold mines, the minerals, that has the most valuable land. And we're headed to a situation like this in the United States. So the question is, what is it that we must do in this period when it seems like the odds are against us? Well, I'm gonna tell you something. The odds have always been against us, but we have always risen to the occasion. We have always found, in a dire time of darkness, we found a way to unify and pull ourselves together and fight back effectively. That's how we fought against slavery. That's how we fought. Wallace got in the door of that university. He stretched out his arms and he said, segregation now, segregation forever. And he made people believe that there was no way that the system of Jim Crow apartheid could be overthrown. But he didn't know who was coming. Martin Luther King, Rosa Parks, Fannie Lou Hamer. He didn't know who was coming. He didn't know the depth. He didn't know the strength. He didn't know the determination of the people that he was confronting. The people who were not afraid to fight back. I tell you, we got a lot of problems in our community. There's a lot of drugs. There's a lot of crime. We got a lot of problems. But I stand here today. I stand here like never before, proud to be a black man in the United States of America. Proud to be a descendant of those people who stood against the odds, who in fact fought back when it seems like there was no way ever that they could win. But we won, we beat them in slavery. We beat them in Jim Crow. And I'm telling you, we'll beat them again. But brothers and sisters, we're not gonna beat them with just wishing and just hoping. We need, and this year, this is a gubernatorial year in New Jersey. Now, we look over the panorama of the United States. 50 states, Republicans control 32 governor's offices and 32 state legislatures. We must make sure they do not get control here in New Jersey. We must make sure we do not need another Chris Christie in office. Now I know people got problems with this, and Pastor, let me know if I'm over time. No, I'm not gonna endorse. I'm not gonna endorse anybody. I just wanna know about time. I'm over time. All right. No, I'm not gonna endorse nobody. Not here. I don't wanna get nobody in no trouble. But I wanna tell you, we have to do everything that we can to not strengthen the hand of the oppressor. We have to do everything we can. And I know some of my more radical friends don't like to hear this. You know I'm for marching. Ain't nobody marched more in this room. Nobody marched more than I have. I've been marching since 1971. My first act of civil disobedience, my first school walkout and takeover of the Gateway Hotel was in 1971. I've been marching and sitting in and protesting and taking over all my, and will continue to do so. But after the marching is over, we got to go to the ballot box. We got to go to the ballot box. And Trump only won, first of all, he didn't win the election. Hillary Clinton won the popular vote by 3 million, more than any other candidate in the history of the United States. He won the Electoral College by 74 votes. But I'm gonna tell you something. The election was stolen. And it was stolen through voter suppression. This is a fact. But I'm telling you, the more they suppress our vote, the more we need to register and go to the polls. Every time we hear about some voter suppression, we should take a voter registration form out of our pocket and give it to somebody. We need massive statewide voter registration. And then we need voter participation. And the outcome, I mean, we can blame everybody else, but I have to say this. A lot of our people didn't come out to vote. And that's one of the reasons we got the outcome that we had. Because a lot of our folks didn't come out to vote. I don't know how you can utter the name. You walk around here with a Malcolm X hat on and a Malcolm X t-shirt and a Dr. King button and this and that. How can you do that and then not go to the polls? We paid for the right to vote with our blood. Now, who you vote for is your business, but you got to go vote. You can vote for whoever you want, but don't sit home. This is not rhetoric that people died. We can name names. We can talk about Goodman, Schwerin, and Cheney that were doing voter registration when they were killed. We can talk about Viola Liuzzo. We can talk about Jimmie Lee Jackson. Everybody ran down to see the movie Selma. And then the same people that went to see Selma didn't go to the polls and vote. Everybody that ran down to see 12 Years a Slave. But when it came time to fight against present-day slavery, they wasn't on the battlefield. Everybody ran down to see Birth of a Nation about Nat Turner, and wasn't he great? And then didn't go to the polls. That doesn't make sense to me. Now, maybe it makes sense to you, but it doesn't make sense. We need massive voter registration. And we need massive voter education. And we need massive voter mobilization. And the People's Organization for Progress, we're going to be calling on March 4th for a meeting to put together a black agenda to put to the gubernatorial candidates. You let these candidates come through here. I saw the pastor's back bristle early. You scared me for a minute. You were so stern. But these people run through our churches at election time, and we let them say whatever they want to say, and then they're out of here. No, we need, wait a minute. No, you're not running out of here. What is your position on the privatization of public education? What is your position on student debt? What is your position on home foreclosure? What is your position on runaway shops? What is your position on affordable housing? What is your position on black representation on boards of agencies and public institutions around this state? See, we got to be more exacting with our leadership, because when you're not exacting, they can tell you anything. That you like them because they look nice, because they dress nice. But this ain't about looks, dread. This is not about romance. This is about the business of the uplift of our people and the uplift of our community. So on March 4th, we want you to come out, St. Paul, and join us and help us put together this black agenda. And then we'll be marching on Dr. King's, the anniversary of his assassination. And we're going to march for reparations in June. And then we're going to be part of putting together a national agenda, a freedom agenda in the fall. But this is a time for mobilization, brothers and sisters. This is a time for all of us to to get on the line. Because our struggle, the great lesson of our history, is that our struggle is a long distance struggle. And we have to be long distance runners. The race goes not what? To the swift, but to those who endure to the end. And we endure. We're an enduring people. We're not even supposed to be here, but we're here. We survived slavery. We survived Jim Crow. We survived Nixon. We survived Reagan. We survived Bush. And we're going to survive Trump. Power to the people. Thank you very much, brothers and sisters.